This conference will now be recorded.
Okay, thank you. Is what we have learned in the previous class? What we have learned in the previous class. As we have learned random forest classifier and the random forest regressor. Okay. And we have also learned to select our best parameters, hyperparameter tuning. Also, we have learned using randomized search CV, right? What is the today agenda is, let us learn the other algorithm called support vector machine, which deals with a linear and nonlinear data. And we will also see grid search CV today. We can also select the good parameter values using grid search CV. Let us see with that today, and we will then close our support vector machine. Okay. Generally, your support vector machine is used for both classification and regression, but it is mostly used for, it can be generally used for both classification and regression, but mostly it will be used for classification problems. Now let us see how does this algorithm tries to classify your data. Let us see. Okay, first I want to give you a general example. See, if think that there are two teams of players, okay, think that there are two teams of players. The red color team and blue color team. See, these two teams are trying to fight with each other. Okay. These two teams are trying to fight with each other in a game. Then what does the higher officials do this? Want to do is, they want to give some decision, give some boundary to these two teams. Okay. Think that these two teams are trying to fight with each other on one point in a game. Okay, what does the higher official is doing is trying to create a boundary for these two teams. Okay, if I want to create, if the higher official or the head want to create a boundary, suppose for these two teams, if I create a boundary in this way, let me use other color. See, for these two teams, if I draw a boundary in this way, okay, will they satisfy? Will the two teams satisfy? Please tell me. If I draw a boundary here, okay, they are trying to fight with each other on one point while playing the game, okay. So the head is trying to give one boundary, and if these two teams crosses this boundary, they will be out of the team. Okay. What the head has done is, he tries to give a boundary line here. Will that be okay to the team red or blue? Tell me. Why am I not getting any responses? You didn't understand what I have said. Please respond. Students, is my voice audible? Please respond. Yes, but you didn't understand the question. Please tell me. Audible, but say once again. That means you are not listening the class properly. See, assume that there are two teams. They are playing some game, okay? They have fought, they are fighting with each other. The two teams are fighting on one point. What is the head trying to do is, he is trying to draw one decision, nothing but draw one boundary between two teams, okay? And he, by drawing this boundary, he can solve the problem on the point that they are fighting, okay? Assume this is the situation. See, if I draw my boundary this way, will that be okay to the two teams sitting that this boundary is drawn on one particular point that if either of the two teams have crossed this boundary, they will be out of the team. Okay. If the head has drawn the decision boundary here, will that be okay to the red team or blue team? Please tell me. Yes, Nagamani has responded. What about the others? It will not be okay for blue team. Yes. See, it will be not be okay for blue team. See, yes, blue team is very far away from this line and this line is very nearer to red team. Okay, there are more chances that the red team crosses this boundary line and there are less chances that this blue team crosses the boundary line. Okay, that means this red team will not accept why the boundary line is so nearer to us. This is not fair. You should draw this boundary line in a correct way. The red team will ask like that, right? And what your what the head will try to do is again draw one decision boundary. Okay, what he tries to do again, he tries to do it in this way. He tries to draw in this way. She think that they are playing some kabaddi game. Okay, there will be one line between the two players, right? Yes or no? if the line between the two teams has drawn here, that will be okay, that will be okay for blue team but not to the red team. If the decision if the boundary has drawn here, then that will be okay to the red team but not to the blue team. Okay, in how many ways you can draw the boundary? Either you can draw your boundary in this way, okay, or in this way. There are multiple ways to draw the boundary. But at last, what is the boundary that is selected? That will be satisfied both for the two teams, right? And there should be no partiality for any team. That should be satisfied by the both teams. Yes or no? Obviously, they draw with a good boundary only. Think that this is one situation. Have you understood what I am trying to say? Please respond once. Yes. Nothing but in order to, in the same way, in order to separate the data, our SVC see in SVC what it tries to do, it tries to draw some boundary line. Decision boundary line. It tries to draw some decision boundary line in order to classify your data. Okay. In order to classify your data, it should draw some line to separate your data. Okay. But which line is the best line? Which line is the best line? See. To separate the given data, we have drawn this line to separate, or we can draw in this way to separate our data, right? But see, if I try to separate my data, in this way, think that I have separated my data in this way. And I have given some new data point to predict. Okay. That data point is present here. My new data point that is to be predicted is present here. By taking this decision line, this decision boundary line, into which category, either to the red team or this blue team, will that new data point present will be get predicted? Tell me. Based on this decision boundary line, if I give a new point here, okay, what our model tries to predict based on this decision boundary line, or what we try to predict by seeing this, we try to predict it as red or blue. Please respond me in the chat box. Yes, based on this decision boundary line, since this new data point that is to be predicted is present this side, okay, it is present at the blue point side, right? So our model blindly predict this new data point to the blue as blue, but actually this belongs to the red only, since this is very close to the red, not to the blue. Okay. If we cross nothing but if we draw a decision boundary in this way, it is not good. Our model will not perform better if our decision tree is this way. Okay. But when let us use the other condition also. If our decision boundary is in this way, okay. If my blue data point is here, think that my new data point is here. Actually, this is very nearer to this blue, not to the red. The new data point is nearer to this blue point. But actually, by considering this decision boundary, My model predict this point that it belongs to this red category, red team. Okay, that means here what is the actual scenario, what is the actual point is, we should select some good decision boundary, some good decision boundary in order to classify our data. Okay, we need to select good decision boundary line in order to classify this data. Okay, what we are trying to do is, what your SVM support vector machine tries to do, it tries to find out the maximum margin. Nothing but see, wait, I will try to erase. See, what it tries to do actually is, it tries to draw one line, one good decision boundary line. Okay, and it also tries to draw two parallel lines to this. Okay, two parallel lines to this. How it draws two parallel lines is, see, one parallel line I am trying to draw here, and the other parallel line I am trying to draw here. How I am considering these two parallel lines here is by calculating the maximum distance. See, by calculating the maximum distance from this to this line to here. Okay, this distance can be called as margin. Okay, it tries to classify your data with the maximum margin. Why we should select the maximum margin? I think you have understood why we have to select the maximum margin from here or here. Okay, have you understood why we have to select the maximum margin here? Please tell me. If I select, see, if my See, if my line is in this way, think that I have chosen my line in this way. I have chosen my line this way. Okay, my equation, nothing but my decision boundary is this. Actually, my decision boundary is this. And my line here is, my parallel lines are these two. Okay, my parallel lines are these two. See, there is this is also fine, but there is some misclassification here. If I take this line here, the two blues are coming to the red category, which is misclassified. Okay, that is not fine. That is one scenario. Okay, and the other scenario is, if I try to draw the same decision boundary here, see, think that I have drawn my actual decision point here. See, the distance from this point to this point is very less, and from the distance from this point is very high, so that your classification will not be correct when the model is trying to predict, right? Yes or no? I have given already the example how it is misclassified. Okay, that means you have to select your boundary. You have to select your boundary in such a way that it should have the maximum margin. Okay, you should have to select your margin so that it should have the maximum distance. What is meant by margin? The distance, right? Okay, see, it should have the maximum margin. It has from this point, see, from this point, it has some maximum margin here. Okay, the parallel lines that we are trying to draw is with some, we have to use some points here in order to draw these parallel lines, in order to draw your margin lines. We are taking the support of some data points here, right? I have used these data points in order to draw this line to get my maximum margin. And from this, I have used these two data points in order to get my maximum margin. Okay, nothing but we are trying to find out the distance from this point to this point. I have used these, right? These points that are giving support to me are called as support vectors. In order to draw my margin line, these points are supporting me. Okay, I'm trying to take the help of those data points, which are called as support vectors. Okay, these are called as support vectors, and this is also called as my support vector. Okay, and this is also one support vector. And this is also one support vector. I have used four support vectors in order to draw my margin here. And what is the margin? Maximum margin we should take. Okay, by using the maximum margin only, we try to classify the data. We try to take the good decision boundary in order to classify. Have you understood this point? Yes. Next. See, this calculation of maximum margin, okay, we try to do if our data is linearly separable. If your data is linearly separable, we try to do it in this way. Okay, if your data is linearly separable, nothing but I think you know what is linearly separable means. Okay, this sort of example is linearly separable only, right? And what is the next point is, let me erase this. Okay, see here, thing that previously you have only blue point here, not the red point, and it is linearly separable. You have classified your data by using the maximum, okay, by using the maximum margin line. Think that one blue point is present here, okay, and one red point is also present here. Okay, what we try to do in case of linearly separable, we try to use a max margin, right? If you try to separate your data, see, as this red point belongs to this data set, nothing but this team or this data, what we try to do by using the maximum margin, we try to separate the data like this. Okay, since this, if it is linearly separable, by using the maximum margin, we try to separate our data in this way only. Okay, why? This red point belongs to here. Or what we try to do, we try to, if our red thing that, wait, I will. See, thing that you got. The blue point here. In the other way, what you try to do, you try to do classify your data in this way, right? You're trying to classify in this data. If you're taking the decision boundary in this way, what are the problems that arise? See, the procedure that you have learned up to now in order to classify data using SVM, what it is trying to do, it does not want to do any misclassification, so that it is trying to separate your data in this way or in this way by these two lines. Okay, but what is the problem if your data is in this way, because of this one data point, you are trying to draw your decision boundary in this way. Okay, what are the problems that you get? Please tell me. What are the problems that you are going to suffer? Once and tell me. See, the first procedure that we have learned is can be called as a hard margin. A hard margin. What does in the hard margin we try to do? Okay, let me give as a point here. That is called as a hard margin. In a hard margin, what you try to do, it will try to change in the boundary line results in misclassification. Yes. Will try to avoid even single misclassification. See, what is your hard margin is trying to do? It is trying to avoid even single misclassification, right? Okay. And see, what is the problem here? If your decision boundary is in this way to avoid misclassification for this one point, what the problem that arises is we will get the problem of overfitting. Okay. We will get the problem of overfitting, and if I give any new data, your model performance is very poor. Okay, can perform poorly on test data or on new data. If I give new data, it performs wrong. Why? We have already seen the evidence here. Okay, if I have given what is overfitting, see, if it tries to draw it in this way, it tries to by heart these points here. Okay, it tries to by heart in these points, and if I give new point here, the red point here, as we have drawn the decision line, it tries to predict as blue only, not red. Okay, that is only the overfitting here. Okay. This tries to by heart only this data set, these points of data. If any new data given like this, if I given close here, it tries to classify here only, not to here. Okay, that is one problem that can be called as a overfitting here. Overfitting means if I give the training data, the training error, okay, the training error will be low here. If you try to apply on any data set, the training error will be low. And the testing error will be high. Okay. With that, you can say that your model is overfitted, right? Okay. That problem will arises. Then what we have to do? See, nothing but this is affected by those can be called as outliers, right? This will be affected by your outliers. Then what we try to do is we try to use soft margin. Okay, we try to use soft margin. What is the opposite of this? What does the soft margin overcome? Okay, it allows some misclassification. See, this point is what somewhat related to your linear regression algorithms. Which algorithms, please tell me? We have introduced some error to some algorithm in order to overcome the problem of overfitting. Okay, in which algorithm we have seen this, please tell me. It tries to generalize better. Okay, nothing but it overcomes the problem of overfitting. Yes, in the ridge regression, what we try to do? What we try to do, we try to introduce some weight to that. Nothing but we try to reduce the slope there in order to generalize our model. Okay, here also, if we are doing it in a very correct way, if see in the linear regression, what we try to do, if it is perfectly linear with the points, with the data points given, okay, that becomes overfitting, right? In the same way also, if you are trying to classify, avoid misclassification for that one point, we are not getting the better results for the new data. Okay, if we think for that one point, the whole algorithm is, it will be effect on the new data, right? That is why we should, in that cases, we should follow the soft margin. What does your soft margin do? Yeah, it allows some misclassifications. Even though it allows some misclassifications, it works better. In the linear ridge rise, even though we introduce some error by adding some weight, it works better, right? In the same way here also. Okay? And it will be not affected by, it will be not affected by outliers. Even though one point is misclassified here, okay, what we try to do? Even though one point is misclassified, what we are trying to do? We try to use the max margin only. Okay, we try to use this margin only. Or this decision boundary only. Why we are trying to use this decision boundary only? See, one point is not, will not be affected if you draw your decision boundary in this way. Okay, if there is one point misclassified here, okay, that does not mean your model will not perform good. Okay, your model will perform good even though there is one misclassification here. Okay. What it tries to do, it tries to include your, see, tries to include nothing but your line will be like this. If there is a new data point here, what it tries to do, it tries to include that outlier here. Okay. Nothing but see, let me give you another example. See, here you have some data points. And let me take other color. Okay, think that you got some black point here. See, your model has classified in the, your model is present in this way. Generally, what we try to do, we try to classify our data using the max margin in this way. Okay. But if you try to do here, what we are trying to do using the soft margin, we try to include this misclassifier also, misclassification points also. Okay, we try to add misclassification points also here so that our model generalizes in a better way and we didn't get any problem of overfitting here, even though we add some misclassifications. Okay, but this is not good when you add more misclassifications. See, I will tell that scenario later. Okay, if there is one some outliers present in this way, we use soft margin, nothing but we try to include those misclassifications in our decision boundary in order to draw our margin. Now the next scenario is, see, we have completed with soft margin and also we have completed with hard margin. Now let us continue. Then if your data is in this way, how do we classify? It is not possible with the soft margin or it is not possible with the hard margin. Yes or no? But if our data is this way, how do we classify? If you want to draw a decision boundary for this, how do you draw a decision boundary? Please tell me. See, if I want to draw a decision boundary, I will draw in this way. Okay. But this is not possible. Okay, this is not possible for me to classify. If your data is in this way, what we try to do is we try to follow the kernel trick, the SVM kernel. Okay, the SVM kernel. What your kernel try to do is, see, it is plotted with some two-dimensional data, right? It is plotted some with some two-dimensional data. Okay, X and Y. And I want to tell you one point here is, if it is of two-dimensional, okay, or it is think that it is of only one-dimensional, how you try to classify is, you classify your data with the help of a line. Okay. And if your data is two-dimensional, what you try to do is you try to classify your data with some, see, you're trying to classify your data with some straight line. The straight line can be called as a plane here. Okay, plane. And if it is of three-dimensional data, more than two, okay, more than two means that can be called as a hyperplane. A hyperplane. See, if you are trying to divide your data, which is only one-dimensional, that division can be called as a line. That if it is two-dimensional plane and it is more than two-dimensional, we call it as a hyperplane. Okay. Now, if it is of this is two-dimensional, but your data is non-linearly separable. Nothing but it is not linearly separable. Then how do we classify this data? If I draw in this way, that will not be fine. If I draw it in this way, that will not be fine, right? I can't classify my data. There are more misclassifications if I do with the hard margin or the soft margin. What I try to do is, okay, what I try to do, there are some kernels here. Okay, there are some kernels called linear. Okay, and what are those kernels? We have the kernels called linear, and we have the kernels called polynomial, and we have also kernels called RBF. Okay, RBF, and we have the kernel called sigmoid. Nothing but this is one mathematical equation we use in order to classify our data. We have already seen with the linear separable. And what is polynomial? See, if your data is linearly separable with this form of line equation, that comes under linear kernel. What is polynomial? If your data is somewhat curvy linear, then see, suppose if your data is in this way. If your data is in this way, this is red and this is one category and this is other category. We try to classify in the form of curvy linear. This is in the form of curvy linear. Then we try to use polynomial kernel. But if your data is in this way, that linear and polynomial won't work to classify your data. What we try to do, we try to use your RBF or sigmoid. What does this RBF or sigmoid do is, this is two-dimensional data, right? It tries to convert this sort of data into higher dimensions. This is two-dimensional. Okay, in order to classify this data, it converts into higher dimensions, say 3 or 4 dimensions, so that your data can be classified using some plane. See, this is somewhat your polynomial. If it is of curvy linear nature, you try to do it in this using polynomial. And where is that? That is not present in this PPT. Okay. Let me show with the hyperplane. It will be provide. I will show it in the images in your Google itself. SVM planes. See, if you have observed this picture, see, if your data is somewhat in a non-linear way, it tries to introduce the other dimension. See, this is two-dimensional data. Okay, if it is not linearly separable, as we have seen in the PPT, it tries to introduce the other dimension. Nothing but it tries to see your data by introducing the other dimension, say 3 or 4. Then it tries to calculate with some mathematical formula and try to plot it. See, the data will become like this. Okay, the data will become like this, so that now this can be separated using this plane, right? This hyperplane. Okay, it tries to separate in that way. Your SVM kernel will try to separate in this way. Okay. See, this is one example. If you can see more images like this, there is also for the Gaussian and sigmoid. Let me show you without the hyperplane. See, this is one method. This is one kernel. Okay, by using sigmoid, okay, RBF, you will get different planes. It tries to convert your data into higher dimensions so that your data can be classified. Okay, you try to see how your data being classified in higher dimensions. Okay. But you don't totally convert your values into higher dimensions. You just try to that nothing but you we won't do anything. The SVM kernel tries to see how our data will be present in our higher dimensions and tries to separate your data. All that be done by your mathematical calculations. Okay, there are some mathematical calculations for every kernel type here. Okay, for every kernel type, there are some classification, sorry, mathematical calculations. For the RBF, if there is one mathematical calculation, and for the other one, it has some mathematical calculations. Okay, generally, if it is in this way, we can use some formula called we can use some. Formula called, see, if we have x and y, they may use some formula called z equal to x square plus z equal to y square. Okay, as we are finding out the squares of x and y, if you try to plot your z, if you try to plot your z, all your values can be separated. Nothing but the general example that you can find here is, let me show you. See, nothing but if your data is in this way, see all your red colored points are here and blue color points are in this way. Generally, they will tell you this example. Okay, how do we classify this data? We can't do with either hard or soft margin, right? What we try to do, we try to do apply this formula. We try to introduce some x and z so that in x, if you try to plot your x and z values, your x values will be here only. Nothing but your red values will be here only. And as we have used x square plus y square, all your y values nothing but all your blue colored values, nothing but the z values, will be plotted in this way, so that it tries to classify this data using this some hyperplane in this way. Okay, it uses some different mathematical formulas for your RBF, sigmoid, okay, polynomial, and so on. And also for polynomial, I think you know, for polynomial there should be some proper degree in order to fit that curvilinear data, right? We should select some proper degree of polynomial also if our data is in curvilinear nature. Have you understood this? Please tell me. That's it with the SVM. We try to use some sort of kernel types here in order to classify this data. And this sub, I think you have got the point of margin. What is margin? What is soft margin? What is hard margin? And what is support vectors? Please once respond me in the chat box. Then we will continue applying with one data set. See, this is the example of finding out if this your data two dimensionality linearly separable, inseparable. Okay, what it has done with degree two, with if x square means with the degree two polynomial, right? It tries to calculate with the polynomial of degree two and try to separate your data. Okay, let us continue with our SQL. What are the kernel types we generally have? We have linear and we have polynomial and we have RBF and also we have sigmoid. Okay, all of you, let us use one dataset called Wine dataset from our SQLearn datasets. It is present in the datasets which are present in SQLearn. We try to use it, okay? Okay, from sklearn.datasets import. Is my is this font size okay or should I increase? Please tell me. Students, is this font size okay or should I increase? Okay, somewhat I should increase. Is this okay? Okay, from sklearn dot import load underscore wine. Yes, we have completed importing the data set. Let us see what are the columns we have, what are the features and target we have in this. I am trying to create one object for this load underscore wine. Yes, if you try to print this wine, you can see the data. See, we have some data. Data are the values for a particular column we have for particular features. and we have the target names. What are the target names? Class 0, class 1, class 2. Okay. You will be knowing nothing but these teachers. We will be knowing if you know more, if we are related to some chemistry background, right? What are the important features or what are the important attributes? Okay, if we try to see the description, if I want to see my description here, print vine.decr. See vine recognition data set. How many instances we have? 50 in each of three classes. We have class 0, class 1, and class 2. We have 178 rows of data. And we have number of attributes are 13 numeric. Okay, predictive attributes. These are the attribute information here. Alcohol, malic acid, ash. Okay. And what are the class names? 0, 1, and 2. This is about the data set here. The data is the results of a chemical analysis of vines grown in the same region of Italy by three different cultivators. This is about the data set belongs to this. Now let us continue. Okay, first let us plot how our data looks. Let us see our data is linear or not linear. Let us see. Okay, by using seaborn, let us observe how our data looks like. In order to use a matplotlib, in order to use seaborn, we try to use matplotlib also, right? Matplotlib.pyplot as plt. And I am also trying to import seaborn. What I try to do is, how many features I have? Okay, to know how many features I have, I try to do print length of vine dot feature underscore names. See, I got 13 features I have, right? So that for every feature I want the output. Okay, what is the target we have? Let me see the target also here. Target column name, the description I have, right? My target names are class 0, class 1, class 2. But what is the target column name? Where is the target present? The target column name is itself target here. Nothing but the target column key name is target. For I in range of, I have 13 features, right? See, I am giving 13 here. For every feature, I want to check the output. What I try to do is, I am trying to use box plot here, xns.box plot. Actually, in the box plot, I want to, in the x, I want to know the output. Okay. In the y axis, I try to give my feature values. So that in x, I am trying to give my y values. But I have not selected my y values here. Okay. Let me select my y values. Y equal to vine dot target. If I do this, I will get the target values in y. And in x, if I want x values here, wind dot data. Okay, if I want the features here, how do I do? Features equal to wind dot feature underscore names. Now I am trying to pass in the y-axis, I want the values of every feature. Okay. Now what I try to do, x of, I want all rows of data of every features, and I am placing I. Have you understood this line? Please tell me. Then I want to plot plt dot y label. Y label is the every feature name, right? Y label of features of I. Now let me, SNS not defined. Okay, I have not used plt dot show. Let me run this. Data must be one dimension. Sorry, I want see, for every data, you, for every features, for alcohol feature, you are getting the data for every class. Class 0, class 1, and class 2 are your labels, right? For every feature, you are getting the data. When you observe this box plot, yes, there are some outliers. And see, this data is linear or non-linear, please tell me. This, with respect to this alcohol feature, please tell me, is this data linear or not linear? Yes, non-linear. And let me see the other features also. See, this data is somewhat linear. And this is not, this is linear. This is linear, but in a negative relationship. Yes, this is also negative. This is positive linear, negatively linear. This is not linear. When you have observed your data, most of your data is linear. If you have observed these plots, most of your data is linear, right? Yes or no? I think the linear, kernel type linear works better for this data. But let us see, we will try to use all the kernel types and we will see for which kernel type it is working better. Have you completed this part? Please tell me. So Bhavani has completed. What about the others? Yes, done. Some students are there. They are not responding at all. I think they are not listening to the class. Or with the only for the certificate they are attending. Is it right? Okay, let us continue. First, we have selected our x and y, right? We have already selected our x and y. Now let us, all of you split your data. Next part is of splitting only, no? We have seen our data set and we have seen how our data is. And now it's time to select your x and y. We have selected x and y and it's time to split your data. Try to split your data using try and split. From sklearn dot model underscore selection, is it more I will confuse for this. Is it model underscore selection only? Yes, I think it is that only. Model underscore selection import train underscore test underscore split. Next, we should write the parameters here, x train comma x test, y underscore train comma y underscore test equal to train underscore test underscore split x comma y. Let us pass our values x comma y. And let me give some test size. Test underscore size equal to 0.3 and random underscore, can't able to see here, random underscore state equal to, let me give some 30 or 32. Okay, let me now apply to the model after running this. In from sklearn dot svc, svc is small letters only, import svm, no. So from support vector machine, we should class import support vector classifier. SVM import SVC. Now try to create an object model equal to SVC. And model dot fit of x comma y. Let me run this. And what to do after running this? We should calculate the accuracy, right? Here I have fitted whole data. Let me give x train comma y train. Now y underscore predict equal to, what is it? Model dot predict of x underscore test. Okay, from sklearn dot matrix. Or right away we can find out the score also here. Okay, import accuracy accuracy underscore score. What is accuracy underscore score of y underscore test and y underscore predict? See, what is the accuracy we got? 62. You can also test with your training data and testing data also. And for which kernel we got this accuracy, we don't know, right? Let us see what is the default kernel. Okay, help of SVC. What is the default kernel? The default kernel is RBF. Okay. And if you want to know the description of every parameter here, there will be description. Okay. See, C is one regularization parameter. What are the values? Linear, poly, RBF, and sigmoid. Okay. Default will be RBF. And let us know. For RBF means if it is not linearly inseparable, we try to use RBF or sigmoid, okay? But we have already observed our data is somewhat in a linear way, most of our data, when we try to observe the every output, every feature output in the visualization. Let us apply all the kernels here, okay? Let us take the kernels linear and poly. What are the other kernels? Linear, poly, and RBF. You may also take sigmoid, but RBF, okay. Next, let us do for every kernel, let us find out the accuracy. For I in kernel, see model equal to SVC of, okay, we are having the kernel parameter, kernel equal to I, and let us fit the data, model dot fit of x underscore train comma y underscore train. What is the next step? For every kernel, we should print the accuracy, right? Print for kernel. Let me use this is one. For every kernel, I should print the accuracy. Print accuracy is my accuracy. Is present in y underscore test comma y underscore predict. Okay. Let me run this one. See, for linear it is 62. For poly it is 62. For RBF also it is 62. Y underscore predict is not updated. Why we are getting the same values? We are not predicting the values here, right? Directly we are giving the same predicted values. Yes. Let me predict the values. Y underscore predict. Yes. Y underscore predict equal to model dot predict of x underscore test. Yes, now you can see my model got, my training data got, for linear it is 90, for poly it is 62, for RBF it is 62. That means which kernel is working better for me? Yes, you got 98, 66, 68. For linear it is working better. Okay, if I have if I can change my data, let me change data here for the random. Okay, I am shuffling my data, and again I will try to give that data. See, my data now it is 98 for linear, for kernel it is 66. Sorry, for poly it is 66, for RBF it is. Then which one is working fine? Please tell me. For you also, is it working fine for linear or for the other kernel? Yes, it is working fine with the linear. Okay, but see, we have used poly here, right? In the poly, we will be having the degree also. We should change our degree in order to get a bet, in order to get better accuracy. If it is poly, let us use, what is the degree here? By default, they are using the degree as 3, and this is applied to only if we use poly only. Okay, let us also change that. Is also change nothing but let us also give some degree values to the polynomial and see if for any degree it is working fine than the linear. Okay, let us take some values for i in range. Let us take some 10 values, 10 degree of polynomials. Again we try to fit our data. Let me copy this. Okay. And see, now I have to change. My kernel is to be poly only. But what is the degree I should give? The degree I should give is the I values. These I values, right? And also, let me give C value. See, what does poly, nothing but it occurs for your soft margin. Okay, generally we use for soft margin. What is this C here is? For the soft margin, we try to include some misclassifiers, right? In the margin, we are trying to include some misclassifiers, okay? We should not introduce more misclassifiers into our soft margin, yes or no? If that is based on the C value, okay? If our C value is low, then see, if our C value should be low, based on the C value, per se it is showing error. No, there is a C parameter in your SVC. See, there is one C parameter. There is C. Here there is C parameter. It is capital C. Yes, it is capital C. Try to use capital. That is why you are getting there. See, you should have the low value of C. Okay? Better values are from 1 to 100. You can take the better values for C. Okay? And you can also change these values and observe the difference. Now, let us see if I have to make any changes here? Okay, let me run this. Not for kernel, for degree, right? Let me change degree. For degree 0, 1, 2. See, as we are changing the degree, it is 70 here, but it is not more than when compared to linear. Though we have changed the degree from 60, it has increased to 70, but it has not increased beyond the linear, right? By this also we can say the linear only working better. The linear kernel only working better for this, the data given. Please make a note, make a note of this. If it is completed, please tell me, I will continue. Okay, I'll also try to change as 1.0 and see the values if it has crossed 90 or not. See, it doesn't cross 90 even though if I change C value. Okay, we have not included sigmoid right here. Let me include sigmoid and see if the sigmoid got more accuracy than linear. I think it won't get. See, for sigmoid it is very less, 0.2. In this way we have to change the values and see for which values our model is working better. For which parameter values our model is working better, we should see in this way. If it is completed, please let me know. I will continue. Okay, Bardo has completed. What about the others? Should I continue or wait for some time? Yes, let us continue. See, instead of, see, for every parameter, what we are trying to do, we are trying to say, take some sort of values here, and we are trying to take this for loop and trying to select some best parameter. In order to reduce this complexity, we have the randomized search CV and search grid search CV. Okay. Yesterday we have done with the randomized search CV, right? Today let us continue with the grid search CV and let us know what are the good parameter values we need to take for our model to be good. Okay. Let us import grid search CV from sklearn.model_selection import grid search CV. I will tell you what is the difference between a grid search and randomized search. Both are same, but there is a slight difference. Okay, now we should select what are the values to be passed, what are the different values should be passed, right? I should create one dictionary, as you have already observed yesterday. Okay, I am using some grid equal to. Let me create some dictionary. Okay, I am taking some C values. C values 0. By default, they have given 0, 1.0, right? Let us take from 0.1. 0.1, 1, 1, 200. And you may take any values, okay? Just I am focusing on these values. And now, and the next value is, kernel is very important. As we have seen using the for loop, let us see how, what value your grid search returns. Kernel equal to, yes. Somebody has given the definition. Let us give the kernels here. All of you write what are the possible kernels here in the strings. RBF, and the next one is poly. What is the next one? Sigmoid. The linear we have for, I have forgotten. Linear. These are the kernels. And what is the next parameter? For poly, we should give the degree, no? These are only not the parameters you should pass into the grid search CV. These are just some important parameters, okay? Don't think that you should only pass these. You should also, you can also pass the other parameters which are present, okay? But mostly used parameters I am using here, that's it. Let me use some degree 1, 2, 3, 4, some 5, 6. You may use any 7. Okay, if I give more values, it takes more time to calculate to give me the values. Okay. Next, have I closed my dictionary? Now let us pass into our grid. Grid equal to, I should pass the model here first. What is my model? My model is SVC, right? Or you can also give, we have already created one object, right? For SVC, we have created model variable. You can also give the model variable name here, object, or you can directly write the model algorithm name. What are the parameters I'm trying to pass? Param_. Okay. These are the only parameters I am trying to pass. Let me fit this data. Grid dot bit of x underscore train comma y underscore train. Let me run this. Yes, it has completed. Next, let us print what are the best parameter values that grid search CV has selected here. Grid dot best underscore parallels. The same methods that we have used in randomized, we are trying to use here. Okay. And print, let us also use accuracy. Grid dot with these best params, it tries to give our accuracy. Grid dot score of x underscore. Okay, let us see the testing performance. X underscore test comma y underscore test. See, for C equal to 0.1, degree equal to 1, and for kernel linear, what is the testing accuracy we got? 1.0. Okay, and all of you try to place these values here. There is our actual lines. Place your values here and try to observe the accuracy. I got the accuracy as 1.0 here for linear. If you change your training and testing data, your accuracy differs. Even though I changed the shuffled my values, it has given me 1.0 for linear. Okay, 100 to 98. For you, it has been reduced to 100 to 98. Okay. In this way, by using randomized search CV or grid search CV, you can select the best hyperparameters values and you can pass them to your model to make your model perform better. Okay. Nothing but to give you more accuracy. This is one method to select the best parameters. Also, we can do by using this type of for loops by using some values. That is also one procedure. But to reduce those complexity of writing for loops for every parameter, we can directly pass all the parameters using grid search CV or randomized search CV. If it is completed, please let me know. I will tell you the difference between grid search and randomized search. Wait, Samir, I will tell other students are noting it. Okay, please tell me if you have completed doing this. I will continue. Please respond once. Is it completed or not? Okay. Okay, let us continue. See, when you try to take grid search CV or randomized search CV, okay. CV is common in this. What do you mean by CV? What do you mean by CV? CV is nothing but cross validation. Yes. CV is nothing but cross validation. We are trying to verify our data using some different parameters using for loop, right? In the same way, your grid search CV or randomized search CV do that internally. Okay, using some different training and testing data. Okay, if I give CV as, if there is a parameter of CV, if I give, there is a parameter of CV in randomized or grid search CV. Yesterday we have given CV's value, right? If I given CV, what does it try to do? It takes five different combinations of training sets and testing sets from the given data set. Okay. For example, what are the parameters in the decision tree or in the kernel? What we try to, in the kernel, we have linear, poly, RBF, and sigmoid, right? Okay. And in the degree, for degree thing that it has selected polynomial, or for C, let us take CV values. For CV, for 0.1 and for 100 and 1000, we have taken these values. What does your CV tries to do is, nothing but what does your grid search CV tries to do is, it tries to find out for every linear value, nothing but think that this is kernel and in the y-axis it is C value. Okay, for every linear type, okay, sorry, okay. For every C value, it tries to give you the output. Think that this is not, yes, it is linear. For every linear, it tries to calculate with the C values. Okay. And for poly, also it tries to, for linear, it tries to check with 0.1, 100, 1000. Again, for poly, it tries to check with 0.1, 100, 1000. And again, it tries to check with RBF and sigmoid. For every possible combination, it tries to consider and check your accuracy. With your, how many validations, cross validations you have given? With 5 cross validations you have given, right? For every 5 training data set and testing data set, it tries to calculate all the possible combinations for the data. Okay, for which parameters it is giving the high accuracy, it select those parameters only. See, it tries to take all the combinations. If poly with 0.1 is giving the better accuracy for your model, it gives that output as your best parameters. Okay, nothing but for every point in the data set that given, for every combination that given, it tries to calculate the accuracy. See, for every kernel and for every C value, it tries to check each and every combination and tries to calculate the accuracy. Okay. But this is fine. If you have 1 million rows of data in your data set. Okay. 1 million rows of data in your data set. What if it checks with all the combinations and think that you have the parameters? See, if there is large data set, your grid search CV may take more time. Okay, we'll take more time to give you the output. In some cases, your system will get struggled. Okay, or your kernel will get struck. It won't give you the results. With if you have large data, think that you have 1 million data with you in your data set. If you are trying to apply grid search CV, what grid search CV tries to calculate for every possible combination and try to check the accuracy, right? But in the randomized search CV, the name randomized means in randomized search CV, it tries to check only the random values and gives you the results. If it is of large data set, okay, it is better to opt for randomized search CV. If it is of small data set, it is better to check with a grid search CV. That is the difference. Okay, this is only the slide. In this, the random values will be selected. Out of all combinations, the random values will get selected and it gives you the output. In the grid search CV, it tries to calculate every single combination of value and gives you the results. Okay, it works better for your grid. Small data sets works better, but for the large data sets, you will be having some same values. Okay, it tries to skip those values and take only the important values, random values, in order to find out, check the accuracy by using the parameters. There is only the slight difference between these two. Have you understood what is grid search? What is the difference? Yes. That's it with SVM support vector machines. Now, what is your task to do is, try to apply breast cancer data set. To SVM and tell me which kernel has worked better. which degree and which C value has worked better to you? I want answers from each and every student who are following the class. Okay? Who are following the class only will try to respond. No, that is why I'm telling in that way. Try to apply the breast cancer data set which is present in your Escalon data sets. Try to use the grid search CV or randomized search CV. That's your choice. And tell me which parameters and which kernel has worked better, is giving the more accuracy, you should tell. If you have any doubts in applying this grid search CV, randomized search CV or SVM, you can ask me. Esbargo is getting more accuracy for linear. Okay. What about the others? Same, getting 95, 91, 91. Okay. If you have plotted the data is in linear way only. Have you plotted the data? Okay. See, you should plotting with the box plot is not mandatory. You can use other plots also. What is C value? C value, what is the best C value you got? Best C value. Have you given C value or not? If it is completed, you also try to do with randomized search CV and grid search CV, both. I think you have done with one search CV, right? Try to do with the other one. That's it with today's class. We have discussed what is SVM. Okay. How do we classify the data using SVM? We have seen what is hard margin, what is soft margin, and also we have seen kernel types here. Also, we have observed how do we choose the best hyperparameters values using search CV. Also, we have observed what is the difference between grid search CV and randomized search CV. Try to complete, if it is not completed applying to the breast cancer data set, try to complete by the next class. If you have any doubts, feel free to ask. Unmute your mic and you can ask me the doubts you have. Thank you, one and all.